Jesus calling. Here's what he said to me. If you don't let me wash your feet, I can't your Savior be. No, I can't your Savior be. I heard the voice of Jesus calling. Here's what he said to me. If you have ears to hear, then hear. If you have eyes, then see. Oh, if you have eyes, then see. I heard the voice of Jesus calling. Here's what he said to me. This is my body given for you. Why don't you taste and see? Oh, why don't you taste and see? I heard the voice of Jesus calling. Here's what he said to me. Believe in me and you will live through all eternity. Yes, through all eternity.
I hope you enjoyed that song. It's a new song by John Bell from the Iona community called I Heard the Voice of Jesus Calling. So sang as a sort of a call to worship and a call to spending time together. So I'm glad you were able to join us. Thank you so much for doing so today on this Maundy Thursday as we share this Passover and Seder meal. Just before we begin formally together, I would like to say a huge thank you to the technical team here, to Kirsty, to George, to Gemma, and also to Lewis, who's helped me sort out a few things, and then also to Beth Ashton, Hilton and David, and other people too, who have done all the readings and all the various parts for us to share together. Isn't it great to be part of a church where people join together and try to make something possible? So thank you one and all. I hope you enjoy this. Whether you've actually been to a Passover Seder meal before and have come to the ones we have on Maundy Thursday in the Village Hall in Bamwell, or often in the school here in Kongsbury or over at the Memorial Hall, or whether this is your very first time and you're just tuning in tonight, you're very, very welcome. It is a key part of the journey that Jesus took during these next 72 hours or so. Because it turns out, I didn't realize until I looked up something today, that the time of Passover, often the Jewish time of Passover and the Christian Easter are out of sync because, for all sorts of reasons. But it happens to be that they totally overlap at this time. So our brothers and sisters in the Jewish faith are sharing Passover just as we are tonight. But obviously we will have a particularly Christian and Jesus-centered approach to it. To those of you who know about all these things, just to say that we've had to make some edits because normally a Passover meal would take 2 to 3 hours, so we've had to make it something that we can all share within an hour. And then the idea is that if you are delaying having your evening meal, then we would have our evening meal after this, whereas normally if we were doing a physical Passover, we would be having it halfway through the meal, through the Passover celebration. Last thing just to say before we begin is if you've tuned in tonight or you're watching this on a repeat sometime and you say, I haven't got all the bits. I can't, you know, what's the point? You're very, very welcome. Whether you've got everything exactly as Kirsty sent it out over this last week, or whether you've got the various fill-ins, you've still got a couple of moments where you can go and raid the larder and the fridge and just find whatever you can. Often it's by physically doing things that we feel part of it. But even if you just want to sit and take part by watching this, you're very, very welcome. We're part of a church which is both physical and online. As somebody said to me today, one of the things about the online church is that it's like the first letters of Paul when they went out to various communities. Paul couldn't be with them physically. He longed to be with them. He often begins his letters saying, I long to be with you. But the letters were like the modern day equivalent of being online. We are joined together by the Holy Spirit. And so you're not just watching, you're actually taking part with us, and it's a worship time together. May the Lord be with you, and may he also be with us as we share here in church. So we have a script that Kirsty's very kindly going to be what's called the Ema, which is the mother. I'm going to try and be the Abba, which is the father. We're sitting suitably distanced apart, and in case you're wondering what the third chair is for, this is for Elijah, in case he comes back, or of course, as Christians would say, if Jesus comes back, we wait for his coming. So that's what the third chair is for. We've tried to lay things out here as best we can. The script of what we're going to be sharing is going to be on half the screen, and then also on the other half of the screen will be Kirsty and I and what's going on here in church. And before we just start, we're just going to pause and gather all our thoughts and whatever we've been through today, and just focus on being with Jesus and being with God and being with brothers and sisters who share this meal in so many different places, and of course, not least, our dear friends in Christchurch in Jerusalem. So let's just be still for a moment, and then we'll begin. So Passover honours and celebrates Yeshua, the Hebrew way to say Jesus, meaning salvation, as the Messiah. Our observance tonight is based on the requirements specified in the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament, and in Jewish tradition. We will show how Jesus the Messiah is indeed the fulfillment of the salvation message of the Passover, and how he delivers each of us from bondage to sin and to slavery. Jewish people would recognize this Seder as a covenant meal. For the Jews, it recalls the covenant Moses made with God at Mount Sinai. And the Messianic Passover Seder reaffirms this covenant in Jesus. As we proceed, let us remember that the Last Supper was a Passover Seder meal, as we're sharing tonight, celebrated by Yeshua himself and his first followers on the night before he died. We will use the traditional Hebrew prayers, which are believed to have been used by Jesus himself on that night in the upper room. We are very grateful to everyone who has contributed to this evening to make it possible. It is our first attempt at trying to do a Passover Seder online, so please bear with us. Whether you have all the traditional ingredients together or not, you're very welcome to raid your cupboards, or if you wish to listen, simply listen, you are very welcome. We hope you enjoy being with us and with Jesus himself as we share this evening. So we come to the first part, searching for leaven. As we observe the Passover, we recall the command, this is a day you are to commemorate. For the generations to come, you shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance, taken from Exodus chapter 12, verse 14.
As it is written in Exodus, in preparation for the Passover, God commanded the people of Israel to remove all leaven or yeast from their house.
It is from this concept of the cleansing of leaven that St. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Don't you know that a little yeast leavens the whole batch of dough? So get rid of the old yeast so that you may be a new unleavened batch as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the festival, not with the old leavened bread with malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. So, O God, we come to you recognizing you as the source of all we have and all we are. We set apart this night to remember your mighty acts as you preserved and protected your people Israel. You have given yourself to all who believe in you. Let this night be an occasion for us to experience the depth of the meaning of the Lamb of God, whose blood was shed for each of us at Calvary. We remember the day on which the Israelites went forth from Egypt, from the house of bondage, and how you freed them with a mighty hand. It was not simply they who went forth, but all of us who have been freed from this bondage of sin. So in the name of Yeshua, Jesus the Messiah, amen.
Amen.
Kirsty.
May the lights we now kindle inspire us to use our gifts. Do you want to do that one for social distancing?
Okay, thank you.
Inspire us to use our gifts to spread your word and light to all the world. Use us, O God, to heal and not harm, to help and not hinder, to bless and not curse, to serve you, O God, our rock and our redeemer.
Now Beth's going to share with us this same blessing in Hebrew.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kiddushenu B'Yeshua Asher Bishmo Madlikim Anaknu Ner Shel Yom Tov. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us in Yeshua, in whose name we light the Passover lights. Amen.
Thank you, Beth. We're going to share a number of songs and hymns tonight, and the first of these is Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus, Vast, Unmeasured, Boundless, Free. Thank you, George. You're doing really well. Glorious, let rest above. Next slide now.
Now next slide. You're doing amazing.
Yeah.
It's super stressful being there. You're doing amazing.
No!
Just don't worry. That's they need those words, don't they? That's the last verse. The great hymns, and the reason we wanted to sing that tonight was because although we're sharing with our brothers and sisters, we also remember that our whole point of doing all this is to focus these next few days very much on the person of Jesus. Whether you've had this wonderful Lent journey where you've been able to be faithful to him throughout this Lent, or whether you're just picking up things tonight, then you're very, very welcome, and we can all join in at the same point together. So we come now to the sanctification of the meal. We serve a holy and righteous God. The purging of leaven made the house holy. Confession made each of us holy, and the lighting of the candles made the day holy. Now the first cup of wine makes the meal holy. This is where you need your first cup of wine. I'm going to give one to Gemma. Here you go, Gemma. I'll give one to George. There we go. And Lewis, my friend, would you like to have one? You don't drink all of it. You just drink some of it in a minute. Just got to say a prayer first, all right? Lots of things we've got to do. The first cup we drink is the cup of sanctification. The word sanctification means to separate. It is our faith in Yeshua, the Messiah, which separates us and separates us from to live holy lives. Let us then take this cup together and proclaim the holiness of this day of deliverance. We raise our glasses. Cheers, everybody, and you have a sip. I don't know whether you're using juice at home or whether you're using wine, whichever you'd like to do, you're very, very welcome. And David is now going to share the same prayer as we share and bless this cup. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Thanks, David. Bless you. I'm glad both Beth and David, we've got these wonderful people who know so much about the Hebrew tradition sharing with us. So that's really good. So we come now to the washing of hands. And you may have a bowl to do this. You may have just gone and got yourself a little bowl from the sink or whatever. Now, I don't know about you, but when I've shared this before, whether it be the washing of hands or the washing of feet, which is the story that is in John's Gospel, I've often seen it as a way of us joining in with Jesus and those disciples, knowing that actually we are being forgiven, we're being loved, we're being healed, cleansed, like you would if your feet were being washed. You're being washed physically. What I didn't realize until I looked this up a little bit earlier was that indeed to do this meant that Jesus was helping you to feel that you're part of a priesthood. It goes right the way back to the book of Exodus, those who like to look up these things, Exodus chapter 30. And every time the priest came into the tent of meeting, they would have washed their hands and washed their feet. And it was a command of the Lord. And in that sense, it's great that we are called to walk with Jesus during these days, as not just as bystanders or spectators, but actually as those who are called to the priesthood of all believers who walk with him as his disciples, both 2,000 years ago and tonight. In the days of the temple, hand washing was part of the process of purification to the Lord, the holy, to be holy unto the Lord. The purification process also included sacrifice, because no amount of water could cleanse us from our sins. As we wash our hands, let us then also reflect upon the gesture of humility and the lesson of service made by Jesus Yeshua himself, our Messiah, when on this night he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing for you, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." But of course, Jesus did. Now, Kirsty and I are going to do this sort of 2 meters apart, but wherever you are, whether you're on your own or whether you're with someone else, even if you can only find a glass of water, just have that experience of recognizing what a humble thing it was for Jesus to come and wash your hands, your feet, and call you to be part of this priesthood of all believers. Amazing. Kirsty's got amazing nails. Bless you. I've got a towel there, Kirsty, somewhere. There you go. Would you be so kind as to hold that for me? There we go. Hold on. And then, George, do you want to do that for Lewis? Oh, I'll do it for Lewis. Here you are, Lewis. I'll hold it. Put your hands in there, mate. Both hands. No, don't worry about that. Both hands. That's it. Yeah. That's right. That's it. Well done. There you go. Now you wipe your hands. Well done. Brilliant. That's one of the things about this meal. There's so many bits to it, but it's meant to be fun. It's meant not to be just a serious thing. It's meant to be fun. One of the things I love about when we've had the Seder meals in Jerusalem at Christ Church this ceremony mean to you? Down the Egyptians. The questions we're about to ask provide the opportunity to tell the story in a way so that the past, present, and future all come together as we see God's hand upon us.
And so, the traditional questions are asked.
How different this night is from all other nights. On other nights, we eat bread. Why on this night do we eat only matzah? On all other nights, we eat all kinds of vegetables. Why on this night do we eat bitter herbs? On all other nights, we do not dip our vegetables even once. Why on this night do we dip them twice? On all other nights, we eat our meal sitting. Why on this night do we eat our... Do we eat reclinedly?
Well done.
The answer.
It is both a duty and a privilege to answer the four questions of Passover and recite the mighty works of a faithful God.
Well done.
On nights, we eat bread with leaven. Unleavened bread. Israel fled from Egypt. God's salvation was so swift that they didn't have time for their dough to rise. Instead, the hot desert sun baked it flat.
But even more than that, the scriptures teach us that the leaven symbolizes sin. During the season of Passover, as we wait for the Messiah's swift return, let us break our old habits of sin and selfishness and begin a fresh, new, and holy life.
The matzah, or unleavened bread, that we use in the Seder is kept in a linen container. The container has three compartments to hold three matzoh, which symbolizes a unity or a shard.
We who know Yeshua as our Messiah can see in this the unity of the Trinity, God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So in the matzah, we can see a picture of Yeshua, the Messiah. Put that down for a moment, for it is striped. Don't know whether you can see these stripe lines running down it like that. It's sort of, might be better that way actually, running down it like that. We say together, but he who was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. It is also pierced. You see all the little holes in this mat, so hopefully if I hold it up against the backlight there, you can see the holes. We say together, and I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one who mourns for his only son. That's taken from Zechariah chapter 12. Let's take the middle matzah. And we break it in two. So if you've got one of these at home, you try and break them in two, and then you put half of it in the cloth. If you've got a cloth at home or a serviette or whatever you happen to have. Now, a bit hard for us to hide it. Normally there would be this moment where we all close our eyes and we hide the half of the matzah, and then later on in the meal, the children and young people who join us would go looking for it, and the one who finds it gets a prize.
So this piece is now called the Afikomen, which means the coming one.
It is wrapped in a white cloth, just as the Messiah's body was wrapped for burial. It is hidden as the Messiah was placed in a tomb, hidden for a time. But just as the Afikomen will return to complete our Passover Seder, so the sinless Messiah also rose from the dead to ascend into heaven.
So now, whether you're at home or here in church, you need to close your eyes while Kirsty tries to go and hide this somewhere suitable.
No peeking.
This is the bread of affliction, the bread which the Israelites ate in the land of Egypt. Break that into pieces. If you would like to have some at home, and we have some here. Thank you. I'm distributing it. Do you want to say the words?
Among people everywhere, and especially as part of a covenant meal, the sharing of bread forms a solemn bond of fellowship. Let us now share a piece of the bread of affliction, the bread of Passover. Thank you. And David Ashton Hilton is now going to pray the Hebrew prayer over the bread.
On this particular tallit or prayer shawl, on the border there are 12 of the Hebrew names of God, and one of them is familiar to most of us, Jehovah Jireh, my provider. And the prayers that we pray over the bread and the wine are prayers of thanks to the Lord, our provider. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzei lechem min haaretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth.
I love it. I don't know whether you ate your bread at home. You ate it. We waited for David, but I don't know whether you at home ate your bread before David finished the prayer, but some people here did, but they will remain anonymous. So enjoy your little bit of matzah. It's a lot to get through just to get to a little bit of matzah, isn't it? We now come on to one of the bits that most of the young people who come to this meal really enjoy, what's known as the bitter herbs. I think Lewis hasn't had this before, he's in for a treat. Kirsty.
On Passover, we eat bitter herbs. As sweet as our lives are today, let us still remember how bitter life was for the children of Israel in the land of Egypt.
Similarly, as believers in Jesus, Yeshua, our Messiah, we remember the bitterness of bondage to sin and to death, from which the Messiah has freed us. So what you need to do now is, this is where you need your horseradish. You take a little bit of your matzah that you may have got, And you dip it in your horseradish and you eat it. I'm going to pass this to everybody here. Give that to Gemma. I don't know whether you what your horseradish is like at home. There you go, Kirsty.
Oh, yummy. Thank you.
It feels very strange having horseradish without roast beef, I have to say, but it's once a year. Give that to your mum. There we go. And if you need to take a little sip of, there you go, Lewis. Just put it in, go for it, mate. It's best if you just go for it. Excuse me for eating while my mouth full, but we want to keep going because there's a lot to get through. So that's the bitter herbs. Gemma's drinking half of her juice before she's finished. I'm not surprised. Okay, Kirsty, over to the Haraset.
The children of Israel toiled to make treasure cities for Pharaoh, working in brick and clay. We remember this task in the Haraset. Let us once again eat of the bitter herbs, but this time we add the sweet Haraset to remind us that even the most bitter of circumstances can be sweetened by the hope we have in God.
So this is where you need to do the same thing again, but this time, if you've got some honey, or George has very kindly made some Haraset for us here, so you put some of that on top to remind yourself that even the most difficult situations can be made better. Yeah, thank you. Give you a chance to do this at home. All right. Yeah. That for me. Thank you. That's much better. Hello, you guys.
Can I pass that?
There you go. Can you pass that to Gemma? Hi. Same. Lewis? There we go. And then lastly, for yourself, Lewis. Come and stand here, my friend, and then you just put that straight in your mouth. One go. Ready? Yep. Ready? Go for it. There you go. No, don't spill it on the floor. Don't spill it on the floor, because we just washed the carpet. Go for it. Okay? Okay. Everybody here has gone for water and everything else. I don't know. So that represents the mortar of the bricks that the Israelites used to have to make. We move on to the carpus. This is where we would be remembering the Passover lamb itself. The wine we drink is red in colour, reminding us of the blood of the Passover lamb. The parsley, Oh, you go for it, Kirsty. The parsley reminds us of the hyssop that applied this blood to the doorposts of the homes of the Hebrew slaves. The salt water reminds us of the tears shed in bondage and of the waters of the Red Sea and of our baptism through which we have passed to safety.
So on this night, we dip the greens into salt water to remind us of the tears shed in bondage.
We remember how Yeshua turned our tears of sadness into joy, and we praise him for the abundant life into which he has brought us. So this is where you take some parsley or whatever you can get your hands on, and you dip it into some salt water. The two wonderful people just come and lit a candle. Can I wish you both a happy Easter? Happy Easter, everybody. God bless you. And then you try and do this. Lewis, you need to do this for Gemma. Hold that carefully. Don't spill it, will you? I know. And you give that to Gemma and she dips it. That's it. Then left hand, you give that to your mum. Do the same thing. Do this thing at home if you can.
This bit's for you, Lewis.
Probably a bit big.
Half the parsley.
And that's for you, my friend. You dip that in there. That's it. And you eat it. That's it. And is that for me, is it? I seem to have ended up with a big bit.
That's all right.
Thank you so much.
I'll eat another bit. I like parsley.
No, it's not too salty. Okay. I have to say, I do cheat here somewhat, because some of these tastes are not my idea of an enjoyable meal. That's why I brought some hummus. So if any of you have got any hummus at home and you just want to clean your palate, I know Beth and David would probably have strong words with me, but that tastes a lot better. Right, over to Kirsty, because we're going to recline.
Tonight, we recline. On this night, we may recline because in ancient times, that was the posture of the free people at meals. They would sit at low tables and lean back against pillows placed against the wall. Those whom God liberated in the Exodus were no longer slaves.
Similarly, as believers in the Messiah, we know that we too have been made a new creation. We are freed from our past sin and pain, freed to live with joy in the present, and freed to live and reign with God forever. Freed by Yeshua, we are free indeed. I have to say, I did watch a little video about how a Jewish believer understands this Passover meal. And I was amazed at how much they make about this idea of reclining, because as servants and slaves, you would have to have stood while everybody else reclined. So we might just take that easily for granted. So recline away at home. You're very welcome. We now come on to the Maggid, which is the story of the Exodus.
The story of Passover is a story of miracles. A story of redemption, a story of the mighty power of God to overcome evil. So we're going to hear from Wendy, from Alex, from Rosemary, and from Ruth. So thank you very much to them for recording these videos.
The Lord had promised the land of Israel to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, yet here were their children in Egypt. The Pharaoh who had come to power feared them. These foreigners in our midst are prospering and have grown numerous, he thought. Suppose they join with our enemies and turn against us. Pharaoh decided to exert greater control over his people, imposing harsh and bitter slavery upon the Israelites. Still, God blessed his people in strength and number. Pharaoh grew more frightened and ordered every baby boy among the Israelites to be drowned in the Nile River. One Israelite couple hid their little boy for 3 months. Finally, entrusting his future to God, they set him in a basket and placed him upon the river. His sister Miriam watched as he floated downstream. Coming upon the basket, Pharaoh's daughter took pity on the child and chose to raise him as her own. She called him Moses, meaning drawn from the water.
Moses grew and became aware of the travail of his people. One day, in a rage, he lost control of himself and killed an Egyptian who was beating a Hebrew slave. Fleeing the palace and the eye of Pharaoh, Moses became a shepherd in the land of Midian, far from the cries of his suffering brothers. The Lord, however, saw the affliction of the children of Israel and heard their groaning. He would raise up a deliverer to lead them out of bondage. It was then that he appeared to Moses in the midst of a bush that burned with fire, yet was not consumed. Moses drew close and listened as God commissioned him to go to Pharaoh. Fearful and reluctant, still Moses agreed to bring God's message to the king of Egypt. Let my people go.
Moses left the wilderness to return to Pharaoh's palace, the very place where he had been raised. He returned with the message which the Lord had given him. But God himself warned Moses of the resistance he would encounter. God sent plagues one by one, yet with each plague, Pharaoh hardened his heart. The Egyptians became afflicted with discomfort and disease, bane and blight. Still, Pharaoh would not relent. With the tenth and most awful plague, God pierced through the hardness of Pharaoh's heart.
This section of our Seder is particularly solemn, as it reflects God's intolerance of sin, especially pride, disobedience, and unbelief. Through the prophet Ezekiel, God said, "The one who sins must die." As harsh as the plagues may seem to us, they remind us that the wages of sin is death. Ezekiel 18, verse 4, and Romans 6, verse 23. The 10 plagues that the Lord inflicted upon Egypt punished them for their harsh treatment of his people and humiliated their so-called gods. He showed his strength as the only true God of the universe. Though the plagues on Egypt were the result of their own evil, we do not rejoice over their defeat. Instead, we recognize their suffering and express sorrow for their pain and loss.
A full cup is a symbol of joy. Tonight we are filled with joy at God's mighty deliverance, but let us also remember the great cost at which redemption was purchased. Lives were sacrificed to bring about the release of God's people from the slavery of Egypt.
Oh, you're working now.
But a far greater price was purchased our redemption from slavery to sin by the death of our Messiah. So if you would like to fill your cup again, if you're running low, just to remind you how much Jesus has poured out his love for you and for the world.
Thank you.
Now we move on to our Passover lamb. The shank bone, which I had to get yesterday from the butcher, represents the Pesach, the Passover lamb, whose blood marked the houses of the children of Israel, signifying their obedience to God's command. We are reminded that it was the Lord himself who redeemed the children of Israel from slavery. Since the temple in Jerusalem no longer stands, lamb is not eaten at Passover. Only the shank bone remains to remind us of the sacrificial lamb.
However, we who have trusted in Yeshua believe he is indeed the Lamb of God, the Passover for the world. We know that it was God himself who achieved the final redemption from sin and death. God himself, Yeshua, the Messiah, who takes away the sin of the world. I don't know about for you, my friends, but that's one of the highlights for me, to remind us that Jesus is the fulfillment of Passover. Now, Kirsty and I were talking about the hard-boiled egg because we didn't know quite where it figured, and I'm sure Beth and David will be able to put us right, but this is what we've been able to find out. It's called the Haggigah. In the Jewish tradition, the Haggigah, or hard-boiled egg, originally represented a festival offering in the temple as part of the daily sacrifice. Since the temple was destroyed in AD 70, the egg is sliced and dipped in salt water as a symbol of mourning. Kirsty's now going to do it. If you do happen to have a hard-boiled egg at home, then that might be good. You're going to cut it in a few more pieces, because we've got to eat it. It'll be fine. And then George is still here, so we'll pass a bit to George in a moment. And Kirsty, I'll have a bit. And I'll have a bit. There we go, George. You need to dip it in some salt water, my dear, for tears, to remind you of the temple. Yeah, thank you. Take that bit, thank you. Ooh. However, in the Christian tradition, the egg has long been a symbol of new life and new birth, hence why we have Easter eggs. In this context, we are reminded of the words of Jesus himself: "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will rebuild it." Reminding us that the true temple is not a building, is not in a building, but in the person of Jesus himself. And all those who believe in him are therefore living stones of his risen body. So we now come to what's called the Dehenu. And there's quite a few responses. We've shortened these down so that there's not too many of them, but we're doing really well. We're well on our way now. So the Dehenu is, "It would have been enough." It's one of those great Jewish prayers that builds and builds. So how great is God's goodness to us? For each of his acts of mercy and kindness, we remember that his goodness is sufficient.
If the Lord had merely rescued us, but had not punished the Egyptians,
Dehenu, it would have been enough. If he had only divided the sea, but had not led us through on dry ground, Dehenu, it would have been enough.
If he had only provided for us in the desert for 40 years, but had not fed us with manna,
Dehenu, it would have been enough. If he had only fed us with manna, but had not given us the Sabbath, Dehenu, it would have been enough.
If he had only given us the Sabbath, but had not brought us to Mount Sinai,
Dehenu, it would have been enough. If he had only brought us to Mount Sinai, but had not given us the commandments, Dehenu, it would have been enough.
If he had only given us the commandments, but had not brought us into the promised land,
Dehenu, it would have been enough. But the Holy One, blessed be he, provided all of these blessings for Israel, and not only these, but so many more. Let us also remember that his grace is then sufficient for us. Blessed are you, O God, for you have in mercy supplied all our needs. You have given us, Jesus our Messiah, forgiveness for sins, life abundant, and life everlasting. And so for us, the cup of plagues has become the cup of deliverance. Let us drink from it with thanksgiving. Cheers, everybody. Cheers, everybody. Have you got some juice? Oh, Gemma, we'll give you some more juice. You have your second cup of juice or wine or whatever you have at home. There you go, Lewis. There you go, my friend. Cheers, everyone. Well, this is where we would normally then have completed the first half of the meal, and we would then be eating all sorts of casseroles and all sorts of other things that people have brought along. As I said at the beginning, we're going to postpone that to the end, but just so that we have a 2-minute break, because it's quite stressful doing all this, and I hope it's worked out for you at home, however you've done this. We're just going to listen to a song called Cornerstone, and what Kirsty and I thought would be a great idea was, if you haven't yet made your palm cross and you've got one of these fronds at home, then you might wish to make a palm cross while we're listening to the song. I didn't realise until I looked up about the palm cross in the context of Passover that actually those two things shouldn't go together. We remember the palms are for the king, and we just take it for granted. But in the Jewish tradition, the palms are associated with a totally different feast called the Feast of Tabernacles, where they make these tents, where you actually go and live under a tent made of palms and all sorts of other things. What's the point? Well, the palm in that context reminds us that what we're doing in Passover is not just remembering some ancient prayers and some ancient ritual. The tent of meeting was where God and humanity came together. And I believe he is right here with us and right with you right now. And to make your palm cross, and the palm itself reminds us of that willingness of God to meet with each of us. We're going to listen to a song and share. Sing at home if you'd like to. And we're going to try and make our palm cross as well. Go for it.
But hold me trust in Jesus. trust in his righteousness alone. Fall asleep before the throne.
Yeah, the last lines of that, because if, for me, that captures what Passover is about, that however you may think of yourself tonight, people have struggled with their mental health a lot during this time of lockdown. The fact that in Christ, because of what he has done for us and he's done for everyone in the world, in him, the trumpet will sound, and indeed, we are placed faultless before God. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. The grace after the meal. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord our God. We say together, blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who is your goodness fed the whole world. With grace, loving kindness and mercy, you give food to all flesh. For your mercy endures forever. May the Lord, the maker of all things, bless this house, give peace to us and to the land of Israel. Now you may remember at the beginning of the meal we hid this aphikomen. And Lewis, it's time for us to share the aphikomen, the final food eaten at the Passover. So you need to go and find the hidden half of the middle matzah. If you're at home and you've hidden it and you've tried to hide it from yourself, then that's great.
Were you peeking when I hid it earlier? No.
Have you found it, Lewis?
Shall I give you a clue? might have to give you a clue because. You're cold in there, Lewis. Maybe try over there a little bit.
Over by Liz's organ.
Warmer, getting very warm now.
There you go.
There you go.
Do you want to bring it here? Could you exchange it?
Well done. I was going to say, if you give that to Matt, who I should have gone and got that.
That's right. Swap you for an Easter egg. Happy Easter.
Was
there
that
you
a good
go.
Trade? That was a very good trade. Thank you.
Good man.
Good boy. Happy Easter.
Thank you. Lewis has wished us all happy Easter, everyone. After supper, the Messiah took bread and gave thanks to the Lord. This is very, very powerful stuff because it's from this that our Jewish heritage that we get the Last Supper, that we share as communion week by week. He said, blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. But then he gave us a new commandment. He broke the bread and said, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us now eat the bread, meditating on the afflicted body of the Lamb of God, who indeed takes away all the sin of the world. Let us allow the taste to linger in our mouths. For you, my friend, a bit for your mum, and a bit for Gemma. All right?
Hold on.
And your third cup, the cup of redemption. The third cup is the cup of redemption, called the cup of blessing by some, symbolizing the blood of the Passover lamb. It was the cup after supper with which Jesus the Messiah identified himself. He lifted up the cup, so if you'd all like to raise your cups, and gave thanks, saying, "Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine." Then Yeshua said, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Just as the blood of the Lamb brought salvation in Egypt, so Messiah's atoning death brings salvation to all who believe." Then you need to fill your cup one fourth time.
Sorry, thank you.
There you go, Lewis. You want some more, Gemma? There you go, love. Right, George. Yeah. So our fourth cup. Let us drink for the fourth and last time. This is the cup of praise, also called the cup of the kingdom. Let us lift our cups and bless the name of our Lord. So we raise our cups. Blessed are you, O Lord, God of Israel, God of our fathers. We praise you for you who are and all the mighty deeds your hands have done. For your love endures forever.
At your command, the earth and its fullness was created. At your voice, the seas parted for those who believed in you. For your goodwill and pleasure, you redeemed Israel and sanctified it to be a holy nation to serve you.
Your love endures forever. You alone are worthy to be praised. You are faithful when we are not. Your mercies are new every morning. Daily you shower us with your blessings. Your love endures forever.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, who has given us the gift of salvation and eternal life.
And this is eternal life, that we might know you, the one true God, and Messiah, Yeshua, Jesus, whom you have sent. And we drink for the fourth time. Cheers, everybody. You have to make sure you drink all of it, everyone. I know, if you're drinking wine at home, that's probably going to be quite challenging. We're nearly done. We're nearly done. Kirsty.
Just got to finish my drink. And our Passover Seder is now complete. Just as our redemption is forever complete.
But let us not forget, he is alive. Death could not hold Yeshua. According to the scriptures, our Passover lamb was sacrificed, was buried, and then rose again. He is coming back to bring us to where he is. Expectantly, we wait for that great Passover. Let us finish with the traditional wish that we may celebrate Passover next year in Jerusalem. We'll say together,
next year in Jerusalem.
We're going to finish the Passover here now. But we've got one last little bit we wanted to share with you, which was to go into the Garden of Gethsemane. And to lead us into the garden, we're going to sing one of the great hymns that we share together, which is "My Song is Love Unknown." And then we're going to share the story of the garden, and we're going to strip the altar, and then we'll finish our service.
Saviour's love to me, love to the lovely show that they might lovely be. Oh, who am I that for my sake my Lord should take for flesh and die? Moved. All right, George. Wonderful. We've moved from the Passover table through while we're hearing that wonderful song, and we're now up at the altar here in Kongsbury, and Jamie's going to read the story of Gethsemane for us. Thank you, Jamie.
Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him."
Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him.
So much for reading that. While we ponder being in the garden with Jesus, then after they'd sung that hymn, and those of you who've been to Jerusalem will know that the walk that takes place from roughly the inner old city down out of the city down to the Garden of Gethsemane, we're now trying to replicate that. By then, each year we strip the altar here in Kongsbury, and I'm very grateful to Kirsty and Gemma and Lewis who are going to help me do that. And while we're doing that for the next 3 or 4 minutes, I'm very grateful to Katie and to Liz who have recorded a wonderful and well-known piece of music which sort of captures the solemnity and also the agony of what Jesus was going through. So we'll share this moment together as we strip the altar here and reflect on Jesus being in the garden. Thank you to Katie and to Liz for recording that, particularly because Katie was trying to do that as well as come down from London last night. So bless you both. Thank you. And so we come to a time of vigil and of waiting. Lewis, come and join me. We're going to say the Lord's Prayer together. Okay. My friends, thank you so much for being part of this tonight. Thank you for sharing this very powerful time. I always find Maundy Thursday one of the most powerful of all the days. I know there's a lot we've shared in the Passover meal. We're overrunning somewhat. But for those of you who've stayed with us, thank you for doing so. Thank you to all the team who've put all this together, all the readers, David and Beth who've advised us. And I hope that this, in some way or other, helps you now just to rest with our Lord as we watch and wait for the morning and then for Good Friday. We share the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're not going to do any notices or anything tonight. It's a way of just being still and resting. We'll join again at 10:30 tomorrow morning. I hope you have a restful part of the rest of the day. I hope if you're waiting to have your meal, you'll have a meal together. And just pray a thought for Jesus in the garden as we look forward then to Good Friday and the service tomorrow. God bless everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. Bye for now. Bye-bye. Bye.
There's a song that's inside of my soul. It's the one that I've tried to write over and over again. I'm awake in the infinite cold, but you sing to me like my dreams are so far.